Thanks so much. Okay, another talk about NHAVIs, really, but hopefully this is a bit different. Basically, I'll go through how we sort of organise and plan and give the results of last year's NHAVI survey. I'll sort of talk about national survey, but it was basically a UK and Isle of Man survey. Lots of survey partners, as you can see. So RSPB, Natural Resources Wales, Scottish Natural Heritage. SRG is the Scottish Raptor Study Group. There's the Northern England Raptor Forum, Natural England Manx Bird Life. Have I got the... Oh yes, sorry, the Northern Ireland Raptor Study Group as well. I've gotten back that. Okay. Just a brief summary of why we're interested in harriers, which has sort of been mentioned already. Really, they're a high priority conservation species, red listed in the UK for their historical decline, basically when they went extinct in the 1800s. They're priority species in each country in the UK, in England, Northern Ireland, Scotland and Wales, and they're species of conservation concern in Europe as well. Also quite a high-profile species in the UK currently. Probably all aware of, there's various... well, they're in the media quite a lot. There's the Hen Harrier Day, that's been... I think it was in September this year, and that's been going on for a few years now. There was Mark Avery's a petition to ban living grey shooting, which resulted in a debate in Parliament a couple of years ago. The Hen Harrier EU Life Project has been mentioned already. And there's the DEFRA sort of joint action on to increase English hen harriers, which is an interesting read if you haven't read it. And there's been, before last year, there were four UK and Isle of Man hen harrier surveys, with the first one being over 2 years in 1988 to 89. Basically, the way we try and survey them in these five surveys, we're really aiming for a complete census of suitable habitat in England, Northern Ireland, Wales, the Isle of Man, and on Orkney. And because the potential range in the rest of Scotland is rather large, we're aiming for a sort of stratified sort of sampling approach with core coverage by the Raptor Study Group members. Okay, so just a quick summary of the survey objectives, really. Is obviously the main one is to provide updated population estimates for the UK, for each country and for the Isle of Man, then to identify trends, national and regional trends, and provide data for then further analysis of any drivers of change in hen harrier numbers across the country and to contribute data more widely and at policy levels and so on. And there's various bits of work that the survey data will sort of feed into over the coming, in the next year or two. Hope this makes sense, really. It's just the map just shows the squares that were surveyed in each country. With the blue and red squares in Scotland showing the sort of a slightly different sort of classification approach, really. The square coverage was really based on producing an up-to-date range of hen harriers by 10 kilometres square based on a number of data sources. So including the last national survey in 2010, the Bird Atlas data from the BTO, consultation with other agencies and from RSPB regional offices, and then consultation with Raptor study groups. And so as I mentioned earlier, the aim was to survey by 10K squares, so that's suppose at this stage, so that's quite a large square to survey, really, particularly in some of the remote areas. But so they're aiming for complete coverage of suitable habitat within defined 10 kilometre squares. Just a quick map to show just the range, the hen harrier breeding range from the 2007-11 atlas. You can see for Wales, there were 38 10 kilometre squares with records during this period, of which 27 10 kilometre squares had confirmed or probable breeding records. I'll talk about this a bit later, but there is the Hen Harrier Conservation Framework was published in 2011, the JNCC report. And the green on the map of the UK is basically by a sort of 1 kilometre sort of area showing the 1 kilometre squares of suitable breeding habitat for hen harriers based on the number of based on the model of a modelling approach within this framework, but we actually use this to help with the sort of selecting the suitable squares and sampling within Scotland. And I'll talk about this a bit later because we, from this data, we can then sort of produce an sort of density estimates by country of the number of breeding hen harriers in 100 kilometre squares of suitable habitat, which is has been quite useful. I've just overlaid the 10 kilometre square coverage from last year over that over the area of super habitat. You can see we've sort of more or less cover the areas. The one bit we haven't, I guess, is in the Isle of Lewis. For many years, although there's lots of potentially super habitat in the Isle of Lewis, for many years it's thought that it wasn't a suitable place for hen harriers because there's no voles, there's very limited, thought to be very limited sort of prey availability there. But in actual fact, the Isle of Lewis is now being, since 2015 anyway, it's now being colonised by hen harriers, which is quite interesting. Okay, go through coverage quickly. And I'm sort of, for this series of slides, I'm sort of comparing coverage and the results from 2016 with the last survey in 2010. So in 2016, we covered 49 squares in Wales by a combination of various volunteers and sort of absolute group people. Obviously, Keith mentioned earlier the Berwyn, so we thanks to Keith for the survey in Berwyn for last year. Other sort of conservation staff, and so in two parts, field workers at the time, so thanks to Mick Green and Becky Dewey-Roberts for that. But you see sort of similar coverage, although it was good to get a better coverage than in 2010, but sort of similar areas covered. Might be able to see, it's not very clear, I've actually marked the two two special protection areas that designated for hen harriers, marked them in pink, so they should appear on the maps, but they haven't come out very clean. Just going through the other countries, so again, coverage in Northern Ireland was much more comprehensive than in 2010, and the survey in Northern Ireland was really organised by the Northern Ireland Map Study Group, with help from volunteers and staff from other organisations. England and Isle of Man. Isle of Man was more or less completely covered with a field worker called by Manx BirdLife and part funded by RSPB and the Manx government. In England, it's a bit more difficult. Much of the super habitat was covered by volunteers through a number of Raptor study groups and other upland bird clubs, mainly through the Northern England Raptor Forum, but there were other groups as well, and then the Natural England staff and volunteers, and went into areas such as the Forest of Bowland, sort of RSPB staff and volunteers. And in theory, there's a sort of a protocol with Natural England and the Moorlands Association, so the sort of the England Landowners Association, Upland Landowners Association, whereby any records of hen harriers on upland estates in England should be reported directly to Natural England, which happens all the time. Just a quick one, going through the Scotland in a bit more detail, because it's a bit more complicated for Scotland given the potential range. So there's actually came up with about 650 10-kilometre squares of within the hen harrier sort of potential breeding range, and we split those up into sort of upper stratum squares in orange and lower in yellow, with the upper ones based on where there were more recent records and where the squares contained at least some special of the hen harrier special protection area, and had squares with more than 50% potentially suitable habitat cover. So we sampled more squares from the upper stratum and fewer from the lower stratum, and a number of squares then covered by the rapid study groups and other volunteers, and we had I think 6 or 7 field workers based in various parts of Scotland. Again, the SPAs in Scotland are all highlighted in pink there. This is actually one SPA, the sort of the Caithness and Sutherland Peatlands SPA, which actually covers 50 10-kilometre squares. And it's completely impossible to get the whole area surveyed. Shows the actual squares that were surveyed in the end. 164 10-kilometre squares in the upper stratum, which is 76% coverage, and 160 10-kilometre squares in the lower stratum, which is nearly 40% coverage. So overall, just over 330 squares covered, compared to just over 210 squares covered in 2010. One on the survey methods, sort of being mentioned a bit by Keith earlier, really, about how best way to survey harriers, but the methods have been more or less the same in previous full surveys, carried out from the beginning of April to the end of July, minimum of two visits to each 10-kilometre square. And again, surveys conducted through a combination of checking through suitable areas of habitat, so walking through, and then a various vantage point watches where you're actually just sat watching over suitable habitat for 2 or 3 hours at a time, just to sort of look for any evidence of any signs of harriers, and then the behaviour of the harriers when you see them. With this survey, really quite an old school approach of any records seen or heard were mapped onto a map of the survey square, and any other information added to a survey form. Suitable habitat does vary a bit, but it's mainly typical moorland habitat, mainly heather moorland, but not necessarily. And in some cases, moorland, certainly up in North Scotland, moorland can be all the way down to sea level. But the general sort of the highest sort of altitude is about 700 metres. There's really no breeding records of harriers above 650 metres above sea level generally. There's also upland young forest and upland mature forest. In some areas, these habitats, certainly in the past, have been quite important. And certainly in the past, in Northern Ireland, there have been tree nesting hen harriers, some up with nests up to about 20 metres above the ground. So it does make things a bit interesting when you have a large plantation, which could well help harriers to actually sort of work out a good way of actually surveying and getting vantage points over those areas to find out what's going on. There's various sort of classification criteria to actually work out what you're seeing, which could then sort of split into proven breeding, probable breeding, and possible breeding. Possible breeding generally is just a single bird seen in potential habitat, means just flying by rather than doing anything else. And it is fairly well known for harriers and other raptors that a certain proportion of the population, particularly younger birds, aren't actually going to be breeding in any one season. And that does vary depending on the other factors involved, such as weather and prey availability and so on. But food breeding is generally, obviously finding nests. The food passing between two adults is quite important. Certainly if you're only really doing vantage point watches and so on, and not actually finding the time to actually sort of locate nests, which more for the field work, because that was probably the case given the additional areas that had to be surveyed. Okay, so the results for 2016. I should say we've got three different estimates, but the one we tend to use is the territorial pairs, which is the proven and probable breeding record. So in the UK there were nearly 550 territorial pairs in 2016, which actually about a 14% decline since 2010. In Wales, numbers declined from 57 to 35, which is actually a near 40% decline. Also declines in Northern Ireland and in England. Isle of Man actually a slight increase, but only sort of up by one territorial pair from 2010. I think we've got some graphs here to show that. Interestingly, for just looking at Wales, 2010 has been the sort of recent high point from the national surveys for Wales. As I mentioned, 57 pairs. The 35 pairs, territorial pairs recorded last year was actually sort of higher than the numbers recorded in the first two national surveys, when there were 27 pairs in 1988-89 and 28 pairs in 1998. But the looking back within each country, it's not necessarily been any one year that has been the highest across all countries. Scotland, the highest annual count was in 2004, which was when the highest UK count was of 630 or so breeding pairs. England, there seems to have been a sort of bit of a steady decline, but from a very low point given the amount of potentially suitable habitat in Northern England. Isle of Man peaked at over nearly 60 territorial pairs in 2004. Isle of Man is quite interesting, really, given that there were no confirmed breeding records on the Isle of Man before 1977. So even though numbers have dropped, they're still, still a reasonable number of breeding pairs on the Isle of Man, given the amount of available habitat. I hope these figures show up. So by 10 kilometre squares in the square surveyed in 2016, the black dots show squares where there were no breeding pairs in 2016, and the red dots show where there were records and they should be scaled Apologies if they're not that clear. And in comparison with 2010, when the scale of blue dots show the rain. So really, in both 2010 and 2016, the most of the population, of the Hen Harry population, is around the two SBAs, around the Berwyns and the Big Mount. With scattered numbers in Mid Wales in both years, really. That just shows a bit more details, split into a bit more detail. But the just scribbled a figure down. If we use the Hen Harry framework of potentially suitable habitat in Wales, that amounts to a density of nearly 3 territorial pairs per 100 kilometre squares of suitable habitat for 2016. Just quickly through the other countries. Northern Ireland's quite, well, a sort of similar scale. The really declines mainly around here, with the SBAs, the two SBAs in Northern Ireland holding most of the records now. The density, there's a slight higher density in Northern Ireland, actually, of 3.2 territorial pairs per 100 square kilometres of suitable habitat in Northern Ireland. Scotland, quite mixed, really. Again, Orkney has the highest density of breeding hen harries. There were 82. Well, I say territorial pairs. Orkney's, again, is interesting because most of the males are polygynous in Orkney, so they're sort of typically provisioning two or three nesting females at any one time, which does make it quite interesting in actually monitoring the birds there and finding nests. But there were 82 breeding females on Orkney last year, which equates to about a density of 20 breeding females per 100 square kilometres of suitable habitat. Elsewhere, the north and south US is high point as it is the west coast of Ireland. But particularly the southern uplands and east Scotland and the North Highlands, the densities are quite low, with only about one territorial pair per 100 square kilometres of suitable habitat. I haven't got a map showing the numbers in England and the Isle of Man, but in Isle of Man the density is over 5.2 breeding pairs per 100 square kilometres of suitable habitat, and for England it's 0.08 breeding pairs per 100 square kilometres of suitable habitat. But, yes. Just to give you a bit more of an idea of some of the change that's happened, particularly since between 2010 and 2016. This is just with the 10 kilometre squares that have been surveyed in all three survey periods. Again, there was, you can see on the map on the left, most squares showed an increase. Certainly last year, a lot of those squares showed a sort of decline in that period. So. It's always a bit difficult, and I think mentioned by Keith earlier, in that certainly he seems to have picked up more pairs in the Berwyns this year, so there is always a difficulty in with these surveys at a few, spaced a few years apart, if you actually get a year where there's a number of factors causing numbers to be slightly lower than expected, it can have a bit of a challenge. But certainly the 2016 and 2015 in a number of parts of the country were thought to be pretty poor for those. And there were certainly, where there was a bit of an issue in some parts of the country, certainly earlier in the season, probably by May, when birds were typically on eggs or feed, starting to feed young. Similar thing for Northern Ireland. Go through these quickly. Scotland, really, the declines in the southern uplands and East Scotland in particular. Quick one on habitat. Certainly for Wales, the majority of birds in Wales are typical sort of heather moorland, which sort of more or less fits to sort of the national perspective. Interestingly, in Scotland, the proportion of the numbers on heather moor has increased, but the numbers on sort of close managed heather moorland has significantly declined. And there's been a significant increase in the numbers on grass moorland in Scotland between 2010 and 2016. Quick one on just the SPAs. Well, currently they basically aren't delivering for hen harriers across the country from the 17 SPAs designated for hen harriers. And in 2016, there were 10 territorial pairs in Berwyn and 10 in the Big Nines, which I think is about nearly 60% of the SPA sort of original assessment of full number of pairs. So it's sort of basically 60% of what was expected from the original population assessment by JNCC. Potential drivers of change, upland habitat change, sort of more or less in terms of heather moorland management, moorland grazing, the amount of muir burn, and the amount of afforestation. General food availability, which I've discussed a bit, and the weather, and of course then there's persecution in some parts of the UK. And predation in some years, particularly in poor vow years, can be an issue, is thought to be an issue. We've already had a bit about 2017 for Harrier, so I won't mention that, and I've also got some maps of the Harriers, some of the Harriers that have been tagged this year as well. Also another point to consider with do many Harriers breeding in Wales winter in England and potentially hits the potential black holes in England where a lot of birds seem to go missing. Something to consider. Just like to thank everyone who took part in the survey and all the landowners and the funders for the survey. Thanks very much.